honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened, worshipless Buddha, consummated in knowledge and behavior.
This is Dhamma on Air number 106, about brooming the mind, cleaning the mind. Why so? Because mind comes first. Mind is the initiator. Mind is of all states the primer. And therefore, if one thinks, speaks, or acts with a pure mind, joy and happiness follows.
Friends, the Four Noble Truths, Chachari, Arya, Satchani, which is the very core of Buddhism, are the following. 1. All this and such is suffering, dukkha. 2. Craving is the cause of suffering, dukkha, samudaya. 3. Absence of craving is the end of suffering, dukkha nirodha. 4. The Noble Eightfold Way leads to the end of suffering, dukkha nirodha kamani patibhaga. The Noble Eightfold Way leading to Nibbana is simply this: right view, sammatitti; right motivation, sammasankappa; right speech, sammavacca; right action, sammakamanta; right livelihood, sammajiva; right effort, sammavacama; right awareness, sammasati; and right concentration, sammasamadhi. But what is right view? What is this initiating and thus crucial right view? Right view is threefold. 1. Right view is of ownership of karma, like this: all beings are owners of their karma, inherit their karma, are born of their karma, are created by their karma, are linked to their karma, and any intentional action, any karma they do, whether good or bad, the effects of that will be theirs only. Follow him like a shadow that never leaves. This is right view. 2. Right view of the 10 phenomena is like this: giving alms has good future effects. Any self-sacrifice results in pleasure. Small gifts and donations are also advantageous. There is resulting fruition thus of any good and any bad behavior. There is moral, ethical efficacy of any relation to mother and father. There is this world, and there are other dimensions, other worlds. There are beings who are spontaneously and instantaneously reborn. There exists good and pure recluses and monks in this world who, by having followed the right method of practice, themselves, by their own superhuman abilities, have directly experienced these other worlds, and who explain them and thereby make them known here. This is right view, too. 3. Right view of the Four Noble Truths. Right view of this is suffering. Right view of craving is the cause of suffering. Right view of absence of craving is the end of suffering. Right view of the Noble Eightfold Way leading to the end of suffering. This too is right view. And for further study on right view, Majjhima Nikaya, the Connected Discourses of the Buddha, number 9, is Sammaditti Sutta, the discourse on right view. This and such is right view, Sammaditti.
Hello to you, friends. This is Dhamma on Air, number 106. There are 3 questions, but first the normal intro, as usual. Nama, tasso, bhagavato, arahato, samma sambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the Blessed Buddha, indeed. This is called mind-brooming, this Dhamma on Air, because this is a daily routine one can go through, and in particular, before going into meditation, then clean out the gross part of the 5 mental hindrances, the Nivarana. Because the first question goes like this. Question 327. 327 questions, that's good. My practice seems to have gotten a bit weaker due to desire, aversion, laziness, restlessness, and doubts. It still affects the lack of stability. Yes, that's a common problem. There's 2 issues here, I think. The first one doesn't seem to be seen. If the meditation practice or the practice during the day is fading away slowly over time, then it's because of lack of stability, which is caused by lack of mindfulness, lack of awareness, lack of sati. Because as soon as mind stops looking at itself, stop looking itself in the mirror, then the mental defilements like this desire, aversion, restlessness, laziness, and doubts, they creep in immediately. So it's momentary, simply. And as soon as awareness is established, either on the nostrils or on what one is doing in general, then they have no chance. So it's from moment to moment one should train. It's very acute. And one will, of course, only make progress in the moments one is training and aware of what one is doing. While as soon as one will progress, but as soon as one relapses into lack of mindfulness, then one starts to regress. And so it's little up, little down, little up, little down. So it depends upon this mindfulness, this awareness, this sati. How to train this sati in an easy way that is very practical and can be done at all times. That is from dusk to dawn. From you wake up and start to go out the bed, and until you get to bed, and even up, all up to the moment that you fall asleep at night, then train mindfulness or awareness and clear comprehension, sampajana. what is that being aware and clearly comprehending? Yeah, the Buddha in his Samyutta Nikaya said the following. A bhikkhu should dwell constantly, aware and clearly comprehending. This is our instruction to you. How bhikkhus is a bhikkhu aware? Here bhikkhus, a bhikkhu lives contemplating these four objects. He contemplates the body merely as a form, just a group of fold and fragile organs. Not as me, not as mine, not as what I am, not as permanent, lasting, not as pleasure, happiness. That's how he contemplates the body. Furthermore, he contemplates feeling as a reactive response assigned to any sense contact. So as soon as there's contact, says Paticca Samuppada, depending on origination, then this feeling rise up. And there's contact all the time. Eye contact, ear contact, nose contact, tongue contact, tactile contact, you're sitting on your bum, and mental contact with ideas, mental states, and concepts. So there's always this contact. Then one of three feelings can arise momentary, and as soon as the contact is gone, then it stops again. It can be either pleasant, painful, or neutral. But whatever it is, it is not me, it is not mine, it is not what I feel. It is just feeling, an impersonal, remote blip of emotion, a felt thing that the mind assigns to any object in a given situation. It's karmically determined. We don't assign the same feeling to the same object all the time. So sometimes you like food and sometimes you dislike the very same food. And so also with the spouse and with the world and with everything. So if you like it, then pleasant feeling is there. If you dislike it, painful feeling is there. So has the feeling assigned to the object has not so much to do with the object as the state of the mind that is perceiving and having contact with this object, importantly. Furthermore, he contemplates mind only as a changing set of mentalities and habituated moods. So he doesn't contemplate this mind as me, as mine, as identity, as what I am, as stable, as a source of happiness. He contemplates as a set of moods that is conditioned by circumstances. But also, if one is aware of it, can be used as a very sharp cut-through tool. Lastly, he contemplates phenomena simply as perceived momentary mental states. So all these phenomena perceived states, which appears to be out there, is only appearances. The world, the monk, the forest, yourself, whatever, is an experience. An experience is the only thing we can witness this phenomena is through experience. Visual experience, auditory experience, sensed experience, and so forth. So there's no world out there. There's an appearance of the world out there, which is an experience. An experience is not physical. An experience is almost purely mental, not entirely purely mental, because the mind and the brain and the sense organs is involved, and they have physical counterparts. But nevertheless, an experience is more mental than physical. So this one should see as it rightly is, the world and the all, as the Buddha called it, sabba, is only witnessed and can only be said to be real in the sense that it's an experience, an appearance. And when one sees this rightly through wisdom, then one detaches from the world. It's not my world, it's not me, it's not mine. It's not what I am, what I'm involved in, what I'm participating in. It's not, it's just an appearance, an experience, a flickering mental state that comes and goes. This he do while being keen, ardent, and clearly comprehending and acutely aware, thereby removing desire, lust, greed, envy, and any discontent. displeasure and frustration rooted in this evanescent world. So this means that all desire and aversion and frustration connected with experiencing the world, this is cut out immediately as this body is seen as a fragile frame of organs. The feeling just seen as a blip of emotion, conditioned, and the mind only as a habitually set of moods and phenomena, all phenomena only as mental states, appearances, experiences. Then one cuts the desire, aversion, and frustration rooted in this very same world. It is this very way Bhikkhus that a Bhikkhu is aware. And how Bhikkhus does a Bhikkhu train clear comprehension, sampayana? Exactly here, Bhikkhus, a Bhikkhu is one who acts clearly comprehending whatever he exactly do right now, while going forward and back, while looking ahead, while looking back, while looking to the side, he clearly comprehends that. While going forward, while going back, while flexing, or while extending his legs and arms and fingers. While wearing robes and carrying bowl, while eating, drinking, chewing, tasting, while defecating and urinating, while walking, standing, lying down, this is the three postures, while falling asleep and waking up, while speaking and keeping silent, he is clearly comprehending that he's doing exactly that. It is indeed in this way that such a bhikkhu lives in clear comprehension. A bhikkhu should dwell aware and clearly comprehending. Sati sampayana. This is our instruction to you. This is from Samyutta Nikaya, Book 5, 142, on the foundations of awareness. So he sees or experiences or perceives the world through these four foundations of awareness. The body as a frame, the feeling as a momentary emotion, the mind as a habituated mood, and phenomena as pure appearances, mental states, experiences. Not as me, not as mine, not as what I am, not as lasting, not as enduring, not as the same as yesterday, but only momentary, and thereby not as pleasure, happiness, and safety. He sees that. He sees then everything he does, whether he's sitting down, standing up, talking, keeping silent, going to the toilet, sleeping, whatever he do, chewing, tasting, he's clearly comprehending exactly that. This is awareness and clear comprehension. Because this carry over to the pillow and to the praxis, one takes one's same level of awareness and clear comprehension, whether 2%, 10%, 88%, 98%, with oneself to the degree one has trained it, to the pillow and to the daily practice in general. So this is a tool that one should develop because it is always on if one has developed it sufficiently. This is a method I use myself at present. It is to see, okay, you're sitting in the forest. One could label forest, but another trick to become acutely aware and clearly comprehending, it is whether there is awareness at this very moment of experiencing forest and sun in the forest, like here back at me and spotted all over this robe and apparent monk. Is there awareness of that? Is there awareness of awareness itself? Then awareness is on. If awareness is aware of itself being on, then it's definitely on. One can fall in love with the object and then start to nice forest, lasting happiness out there. Then it's not on. Then one starts daydreaming, so to speak. And it takes only a split second. Then one is off in one's daydreaming and planning and so on. Autopilot, emotional reaction to whether something is beautiful or ugly or neutral. So one trick can be, so of course, to be aware of any action one is doing, stretching or extending. any limp, any activity, whether sitting down, walking, lying, whether tasting or touching, or whether experiencing with the eye or with the ear, whether hearing or smelling, tasting or touching, whatever one does, one is clearly aware and comprehend exactly that. Classically, labeling has been used to say tasting, tasting, seeing, seeing, touching, touching, sitting, sitting, talking, talking. But another trick, I think, is to be aware of one is awareness itself, whether one is aware or not, whether one is on or off, whether awareness is on or off. If awareness is aware of itself being on, then this one is definitely on, very acutely. Ah, now there is awareness in me. Or now there is neglect in me. So this is a good trick. Next one is this grooming of the mind. And this is, goes for the five hindrances, the five nivaranas. The first is sense desire. Any sense desire is exchanged with a form of disgust or disillusion. So if one sees a sense desire in me, I want to go to the fridge and eat something, or I want to see something entertaining, or something like that, hear music, play a computer game, then it's sense desire. Then one can immediately substitute this with disgust. And one can do that by memorizing a picture of a corpse that is very, very revolting. An asupa nimitta, we call it. A sign of disgust. And when one does that, then desire clock goes away immediately. Then it might come back 5 minutes after. Then one redirects mind to this asupa nimitta, signs of disgust, the corpse picture, or picture of a skeleton, but usually a corpse picture is best. I have some on my website. You can just search for asupa, A-S-U-B-H-A. Then you will find the picture files, which is password protected. That's also a password. So this is a classical trick. One substitutes desire and lust, kamaraga, for the opposite state, which is disgust. Then mind, instead of being attracted, then is repulsed. Then it ends up in zero, in neutral equanimity. This is a very good place to start meditation. If in the other cases present, for aversion or ill will, revenge, grudge, any aversion, any derivative of hate, then one substituted exchange with universal friendliness towards all beings. And in particular, if there's a being present in these aversive thoughts, then one substitutes to him or her by thinking, this being will also be enlightened. This and all beings, will all be enlightened. And this is a very skillful way of using this substitution with the opposite state. So if one sees this aversion, as soon as one is aware of it, one substitutes immediately. The Buddha say, and this is correct, I experienced several times on the pillow, it takes a long time to be aware of it. But as soon as one is aware of it, and if one knows the substitution, the opposite state, one then can substitute right there and right there. But one can be aversive or have desire for hours on end without being aware of it. And that's the difficulty, becoming aware of it, seeing the mind being desirous, seeing the mind being aversive. Then as soon as one sees it, one recognizes it, one knows the trick to substitute. This was desire and aversion. Any restlessness and regret is exchanged with inner calm in this very way. One says to oneself, there's this restlessness and regret, for example, worries, or one have done something bad, then our mind is kind of like trembling or unsteady. Then one says to oneself, there's restlessness and regret in this mind. And then one substitutes with inner calm, saying, there's calm of the body and there's calm of the mind. Two different things. Calm of the body is opposite of one is running, for example. Calm of the mind is opposite of one is stressing, thinking, agitation. It's the opposite states. So just this notion that there's two kinds of calm is enough to calm the mind. As soon as one recognizes the restlessness and regret by becoming aware of it, saying, ah, in this body and mind there's restlessness and regret, then one, udaccha kukuccha in Pali, then one changes it by and stops it on the very spot by repeating this two-factored stanza for oneself, or notion: there's calm of the body and calm of the mind. Two different things that indeed condition each other. If there's the body is very upset and have a large pulse, 200 pulse just after having been running or bicycling or swimming, then it's also difficult from the mind. But if it lies down for to be quiet, to be calm, and so if it lies down under a tree and drinks some water, then it becomes calm, then the mind also becomes calm. And vice versa, if the mind is stressed and agitated and upset, it's difficult for the mind to relax, or for the body to relax and also become calm. So bodily calm condition mental calm, and mental calm conditions bodily calm. And so also with the opposite states. Unrest of mind condition unrest of body, unrest of body conditions unrest of mind. Then there's tinamitta, lethargy and laziness. If one becomes sloggy and after meals or giving this irrational attention, this lethargy and laziness, one can see it, ah, now I'm feeling tired, now I'm feeling sluggish, then one should immediately exchange it with the opposite state, which is alertness. How to do that? Yeah, there's a classical three-factor tool. One says, ah, now there's laziness in this body and mind. There's lethargy in this body and mind. So what is missing? Is it initiative, or is it launching, or is it endurance? Initiative is purely mental. It's when you're lying on the sofa and decides, cut through. The very moment say, ah, now I want to do the dishes. Launching is when the body also participating, swinging out the legs of the sofa. And endurance is when it's finishing any task, for example, dishing up or cleaning. It doesn't jump over and only make half. And it assigns how much do I do, 60% or 2% or 98% of this task all the time. And then gradually over a long period of training this, noting this, all the way to Arahant's trip, because lethargy and laziness is first eradicated at the moment of awakening, actually. So it's a long job, but worth doing is noticing. Is there this lethargy and laziness, tinamitta, in this body and mind? And if there is, what is missing? Initiative, purely mental. Launching, physical, like launching a rocket. Now it's starting. Or is it endurance? It cannot finalize, complete the task. What is missing? Then gradually energy, virya, goes up and up and up and up. Perseverance. And one attains completeness of the task, whether on the pillow or dishing up or whatever one is doing. So it's a fully generalizable tool one can use in all tasks. Is there any doubt and uncertainty in this mind? This is the last thing, vichikicca, doubt and uncertainty. Skeptical doubt in the Buddha's enlightenment and the training and the Sangha and so on, and all our possible states and phenomena. Skeptical doubt or uncertainty. One is vacillating, one doesn't know what is right and wrong to do in a given situation. Then one uses fourfold evaluation and remembers that. What I'm doing now, sitting in the forest or on the pillow, is this advantageous or is it detrimental? One. Is it blamable, others evaluation, or is it blameless? Is it exalted or is it ordinary? Is it on the bright side or on the dark side? When doing this, then one's evaluation of what is optimal becomes more and more narrow. First is a broad line in the sand between the wrong and the right, namely the advantageous versus detrimental. Then this is one's own evaluation. Then one thinks about everybody else's evaluation, the monk's evaluations, and also the Buddha's evaluation of a given phenomena. What would he say? What would the Sangha say? What would mom and dad say? What would my Buddhist friends say? What would the monks say about this? Is it blameless or blamable? Is it exalted or is it ordinary? Is it on the bright side or is it on the dark side? Then gradually, because the line in the sand between right and wrong becomes more and more narrow, until it's a very, very sharp cut between this is advantageous, it is exalted, it is blameless, and it's on the bright side. While this, right on the other side of this, this is detrimental, blamable, ordinary, and on the dark side. So thereby doubt has so much lesser room to live on. So if we say in the beginning you have one third here, you're not doubt whether this third is detrimental, and then you also not no doubt in whether this third to this side is advantageous, but there's a large scale in the a gray zone here in the middle where one cannot assign this to any state, whether it's advantageous or disadvantageous, whether it's exalted or whether it's ordinary, or whether it's blamable or blameless, on the bright side or on the dark side. So this is a way to broom the mind before starting on the meditation object proper. I hope this clears this issue. So there's two factors here. Brooming the mind, first is establish awareness, mindfulness, and clear comprehension, sampayana, in all activities, bending, stretching, tasting, touching, sitting, talking, keeping silent, whatever one does, one should be fully aware and clearly comprehend that this is actually what one is doing right now. Just being aware of it. Or being aware of awareness is aware of it. Even better. And then broom the mind before proper sitting, then it will become more stable from the five hindrances. Exchange any desire with disgust, any aversion with universal friendliness, any lethargy and laziness with initiative, launching, and endurance, any restlessness and regret with calm of the mind, calm of the body, and any doubt with this fourfold evaluation, whether it's advantageous or detrimental, whether it's blameless or blamable, whether it's exalted or ordinary, or whether it is on the bright side, light side, or on the dark side of this very, now very, very thin line between right and wrong. Next question. Question 328. How does one overcome feelings of superiority or inferiority? Yes, this superiority and inferiority actually springs from an improper designation of a self, asmimana, that comes in two versions. There's something called sakaya ditti that the stream enterer, he drops, or she drops. And this is the belief that this is my body, this is my feelings, this is my perceptions, and this is my mental construction, and this is my consciousness. This is my ego, this is my identity. Or I'm inside these five things, so I'm outside these five things. Or these five things collectively are me, mine. There's actually 20 variants of it. It's called sakaya ditti, own group view, or ego identity view. This is the first bar one has to break down. This is not impossible, but it's a little difficult, because one tends to identify with what you see in the mirror. And when you hear yourself speaking, then you think it's me, it's mine. What is it actually seen from a Buddhist point of perspective? This is the five aggregates or the five clusters of clinging. That's what exists. It's a cluster of clinging to form, the cluster of clinging to feeling, the cluster of clinging to perception, the cluster of clinging to mental construction, intentions, planning, and so on, and the cluster of clinging to the six kinds of consciousness, visual consciousness, auditory consciousness, and so forth. So this is what exists. There exists no ego, me, mine, that aims something apart from or inside these five clusters of clinging. There's not. This is a concept. I think it's formed actually every time very early in the youth, probably inside the womb. When one touches the wall of the womb, then one has only a touch in one's hand, but not in the womb. In opposition to when one touches one's own body, then one gets two sensations. One sensation from where one touch, and then one sensation in the fingers. So one designate the difference between these perceptions. This is external, and this is internal. And what is external is not me. What is internal is me. So this very, very subconscious formation of this I am, this Sakkaya Ditti. I am concept, further down the road, is first taken out by awakening. That is the concept that I am. I am. I exist. This is neither the case. Again, what is the I am has two parts, I and am. The I is not there, it doesn't exist. There's only an idea, a concept that leads to egoistic behavior of pleasing this I, despite of whatever circumstance and whatever the consequences it has for others and for the world. For example, the global heating, the forest fires, the floodings, and so on. So this I, it doesn't exist. It's a very detrimental idea. If it's not pleased, then it starts fighting with whatever takes the pleasure away. Starts screaming like a child, or like a pig even. However, what is that aim? The five clusters of clinging, they are in existence, momentary existences. So these five processes, these five activities of clinging to various forms, feelings, perceptions, mental constructions, and consciousness. It is this that exists, not any identity, me, mine, that can be compared to others. But as soon as this Sakkaya Ditti, this my group or ego identity view, wrong view, Miccha Ditti, is formed, then it starts comparing what it thinks is itself to others and say, I'm superior to this or that. I'm inferior to this or that, or I'm equal to this or that. I'm superior to them, to these, to him or she. I'm inferior to he or she or them, or I'm on the same level of as he or she or them. And this, when there is no I, no ego, no identity, then of course this is a foolish and failed comparison, because it's not only is it apples compared to bananas. It is that a non-existent apple or an imaginary apple that is compared to an imaginary banana. So it's two imaginations, two views, two concepts, panyati, that is compared. Neither of them are stable. If you compare your mental state today with your mental state yesterday, then you will also find they are different. They are inferior or superior. So even when this self compares it to itself, It cannot say that it is the same from one moment to the next moment. If it cannot say that it's the same, that it's identical with itself from moment to moment, then there cannot be any identity there. So this Sakkaya Ditti can also be called identity view or ego view. This should be abrogated. When one does that successfully, then one stops comparing oneself to anything, because one knows there is no self. Sabbe Dhamma Anatta. All states, whether physical or mental, they are without a self, without a core, without something that exists independently of the mind that perceives it, in and of itself. There's not. It's all conditioned phenomena, conditioned of many circumstances, most of which we have no control. So this is basically the way, is to come closer, to notice this anatta, this no self, no self, no substance, no self in there, no ego in there, no me, mine, and therefore also consequently no they, he or she out there, and no substance. No solidity, fluidity, heat and motion that is the same from one moment to the next moment. Everything is processes. Arise and cease momentary, they are in existence, but not more than that. So there, in Buddhism, there's no static existence of anything. It's only processes or activities. And when it is that, then one fails to find the substance. It's like a bubble of foam. There's nothing in there. It's poof. When you take the circumstances away, then the phenomenon also falls away. Because it's conditioned, it's constructed. It's a formation. It's not a self, me, mine, ego, what I am. It's not a substance out there, independent of the perceiving mind. I hope this answers the question. Question 329. What to do with feelings of grudge and revenge? Yes, as soon as one sees it, one should exchange it again. It's a derivative of hate, dosa, aversion and anger, grudge and revenge. One should do metta meditation on infinite friendliness and reflect on the fact of all beings are born under karma. Both this imaginary self and those imaginary selves that go around and do wrong action in consequence of being in grudge and revenge feelings. Any evil karma based on this grudge and revenge only makes more suffering. More and more suffering. Huh? Because if the mind is in an evil intention, bad intention, then it creates moments of future suffering for itself. Like a boomerang. Like the karma coming back to its neck, basically. Back to its future. Another trick is to dwell in equanimity and say, ah, now I will not stay either in friendliness or in aversion, I will dwell in equanimity in the exact middle. And this one do by considering this fact that all beings are born, created, conditioned, and shaped by their past karma. They are owner, debtor, inheritor of the effects of their prior behavior. Whatever they do, good as bad, only they will experience the result thereof. Then one dwells in equanimity. This that all beings are born out of the karma goes both for them, one is angry at, and for this continuation of body and mind. So both parts should step out of this grudge. When it does that, then immediately peace prevails and no future bad karma is created. So this is a trick. Going a little further into this equanimity, one can, especially when training on the pillow, one can say there's equanimity which bolsters the mind against these things that are unpleasant, are frustrating. One's boss, a wife, a spouse, or children, or whatever is disturbing one, politicians or presidents, then one can say to oneself, classify them according to an impersonal state. Like this. There's equanimity both regarding all mental states and physical things. There's equanimity both regarding all internal phenomena and all external phenomena. There's equanimity both regarding all past, present, and future states. There's equanimity both regarding pain, pleasure, and neutral feeling. There's equanimity of joy, grief, and indifferent mood. There's equanimity both regarding all mentality and all materiality, all nama-rupa, name and form. There's equanimity both regarding all alive beings and all dead things, physical states in particular. So this that one sees and repeats this equanimity, then one can classify, once if one is another person, then one can say, ah, it's a live being. And both regarding dead physical states and live beings, I will maintain my equanimity. If this is not possible, then use the active part, substitution, with aversion, grudge, ill will, with universal friendliness, from one's own heart region towards the other heart region. And immediately, one's own generation of suffering by a future bad karma, vipaka, echoes that comes back, probabilistic echo that's come back from one's own behavior and one's own consciousness, is silenced. And one, in many cases, will see as soon as this outgoing ill will is silenced, then the responding ego from their behavior, their mental states also fizzle away. In a few moments, actually. In the supermarket queue, in the post office queue, and at the tank station, and all these places where this usually happens several times a day. So this is a way, exchanging. Again, I like to say brooming the mind is primarily something that one can do before one sits, but one can do it at all times. That is, the mind is aware and clearly comprehending. There is desire in this kamaraga, sense desire in this mind. What to exchange it with? Disgust by seeing a corpse picture. There is ill will, aversion, grudge, anger, irritation in this mind. What to exchange it with? Substitute it with universal friendliness, metta. There is laziness and lethargy in this mind. What to substitute it with? Initiative, launching, endurance. There is this there's this restlessness and regret, udaccha kukuccha, in this mind. What to substitute it with? The notion of the calm of the body and the calm of the mind. Ah, there is this doubt and uncertainty, vichikicca, in this mind. What to substitute it with? Ah, this fourfold evaluation of advantageous, disadvantageous, blameless, blameable, ordinary or high, and on the bright side or on the dark side. This is a way, substitution with the opposite state. And then clear comprehension, bending, stretching, seeing, turning head, looking the other way, looking in front, being silent, talking, chewing, excrementing, lying down, going, sitting upwards, walking, or whatever one is doing, falling asleep, waking up, clear comprehension, from one moment to the next moment. One good thing is to do, they did in the olden days, there was a monk, he was seen going from this village to village, this village. Then he went a little way, then he stopped, turned around and went back. And then he picked up his mindfulness there because he has seen that he lost it. He lost it at a given say. So he goes back and picks it up where it is. So he carries his kamatana, his meditation object, on his head. And if it falls down, then he goes back and picks it up. And so the villagers say, our monk has become crazy because it takes him 2 hours from go from this village to that village. Because he keeps going forward, then a little bit backward, keeps going forward, then a little bit backward, and so on. Maybe sometimes a lot backward. And then find out where he lost the object, where he lost his awareness, where he, so to speak, slided into neglect. Right where it happened. Then he took it up from there again, took up his meditation object, and then went forward. As long as he could keep the meditation object in mind, unbrokenly. As soon as it breaks, then he will go on down, remember where I lost it, and go down and pick it up. And so this, of course, bolsters the absence of neglect and the acute awareness and clear comprehension, sampayana, sati sampayana. This bolsters this, and one takes this degree of 2% to 10%, 75% and 98% of this awareness, this mindfulness, this sati and clear comprehension with to the pillow. And thereby the praxis on the pillow becomes stable. Thereby. So it's outside the pillow one trains awareness and clear comprehension and substitution, and then one takes it with on the pillow. But do it this substitution of the five hindrances of sense desire, ill will, laziness and lethargy, restlessness and regret, and doubt and uncertainty. Do that every time before starting with the proper meditation, whether it's universal friendliness or mindfulness of breathing, anapanasati, or whatever kamatana, whatever meditation object one is intending to do. Then first, before starting, one brooms the mind. Because then one starts on a clean slate. If no mental hindrance is there, the jhana, the absorption into the meditation object, is possible. If one of the five hindrances is there, or more of them, more of one, then the door is closed and the practice becomes unstable. So much for today. Thank you for your clever consideration, advantageous attention, and kind contribution. Thanks to all the Dayakas supporters and donors, especially the regular monthly donors. And please email new questions to vantesamahita@gmail.com. And remember to click subscribe down there in this corner. And the bell if you already subscribed, and like if you like. Thank you for today. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Samma Sambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the blessed Buddha. And may you indeed have a nice, noble, and blessed day. Thank you.
You heard Bhikkhu Sammahita from the Cypress Hermitage on the Knuckles Mountain, Pamparela, Central Hill Country, Sri Lanka. Please subscribe to the Google group Buddha Direct and visit the website whatbuddhasaid.net. May all beings become thus happy, thereby. Thank you. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Samma Sambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the blessed Buddha. Thank you for your contribution, and have a nice day.